Okay, so as we round the bend away from 2020, move on in 2021, which hopefully we're all looking forward to. I'm always thinking about what my next vlogging camera is going to be, and that's because I'm a vlogging addict. Even though I'm not always vlogging, I'm always thinking about potentially vlogging again. And if you've ever been involved in any kind of like daily vlogging or doing a lot of vlogs, it's the best of times and it's the worst of times, but it's also wildly addicting. And so I'm always keeping up with what's the latest vlogging cameras and what are the recommendations. And lately I've been thinking about, oh, maybe I should get something, and should I get this camera or that camera? Should I save up more? Should I get less? And I thought, hey, I'll just make a video with some of the research that I've been doing and go through a bunch of cameras, kind of ranging from all the way down to, we're gonna talk US dollars, even though I'm a proud Canadian, but just, it's a thing. All the way at the bottom at $350 US up to $4,600 US. And we got about 10 options in there that we are gonna go through reasonably quickly, but enough to at least get the conversation started. And this is a conversation. So as we get into these, and if you have some specific questions or there's a camera I didn't cover, just drop a comment below. I answer pretty much all of my comments as long as they're reasonable and are happy to chat more. But first, let's talk about what makes a good vlogging camera. And after having created hundreds of vlogs over the years, these are the features that I believe are important in order to make a good vlog and a good vlogging camera. And what makes a good vlogging camera is that it just kind of gets out of the way. You can do whatever you want to do, but it's not too hard to use and it doesn't mess anything up for you. And I would say that that's, at least for me, what's important. So what matters? Good quality video. The video quality has to look good or else, why are we buying a camera? So that's gonna be important. This more subtle nuance of this is good low light performance, because oftentimes when you're vlogging, it's not in the best situations. If you're outdoor during the day, almost any camera looks good, but as it kind of starts to get darker, the low light performance can trail off a little bit and you kind of get this mushy, grainy, ugly looking video. So something to consider. Number two, that the camera, and more specifically the lens on the camera, is wide enough to fit you into it. There are cameras these days coming out with lenses that are just like, if you tried vlogging with them and holding it out here, like you would just get like nose pores. Like not quite, but your face fills the entire frame and we can't see what's going on around you. And we don't need to see your face that close up to camera. So all of these recommendations have at least a reasonably wide, we're gonna say 24 millimeter full frame equivalent. So there's different sensor sizes mess up the ratios, but just know that every camera is gonna be at least reasonably wide, and I'll talk about that. But we wanna have that. Selfie screen, this is so important. I was trying to vlog with a Sony a6600 for a while that didn't have a selfie screen, and I hated it. Even though it was a really great camera, otherwise just not being able to see myself and frame the shots for vlogging, it doesn't work. I'm not interested in ever vlogging again without a camera that doesn't have a selfie screen. And when I moved from that to this Canon M50, I was having way more fun because it just did that. So that's really important. Great audio, they say that you can have mediocre quality video, but if your audio is great, it's easy to watch. If you have the most amazing video in the world and your audio quality sucks, nobody can watch it. So like wind noises and grossness, we need to have good audio. So all these cameras either have reasonably good built-in audio, but more importantly, you can add a mic onto every single one of these cameras like this that will cut down on the noise. It doesn't have to be this fancy, but an external mic is gonna make a huge difference for that. So they have that. Good autofocus. For a number of years, used actually this camera, same camera in front of me, a Panasonic G7, and I was just watching a video I wanted. I went around to a local shop promoting amazing local places for great Christmas products, and I was like, I should post this video again. And I went back and I looked at it, and like half the video, my face is out of focus because the autofocus on this was so bad, and it would like come into focus, and then the background would be in focus, and naturally people's eyes are trying to focus on the background, not my face, and it's a mess. You need to have good autofocus. Thankfully, we've got good options for good autofocus. Stable, not too shaky. Having a really shaky video is jarring and it can make it tough to watch for a long period of time. So we wanna at least make sure either the lens has some stabilization in it, the camera maybe has stabilization in it, or there's one other option where they actually have a built-in gimbal, which is like a stabilizer. But you wanna have some stabilization for that. And the last one is okay in the elements. Meaning if you're vlogging in sandy places, dusty places, cold, wet, You're going to want to make sure you pick a camera that is good in the elements. Not all of these are going to be the greatest, but I vlogged on a camera that didn't have any weather sealing for years and in sand and snow and wet, and it did okay. It maybe wasn't the safest thing to do, but anyway, we'll talk about that. But those are kind of the main features that are going to make a good vlogging camera. So we'll kind of shoot through these and kind of apply some of those to the cameras and make some recommendations all the way through the different price brackets. Ready to go? Number one, and it's crazy now that we have a good option at $350 US, and that is the DJI Pocket 2. And I'm actually gonna take you from 350 up to 400 bucks because you can add on the ultra wide angle lens adapter. Now, this is a tiny little pockety camera with a built-in gimbal that can do 4K 60 frames per second, can fit in your pocket, good 1080p quality as long as you have enough light, super smooth, stable, shoots HDR video for kind of great colors and dynamic range. But just know that this is a camera that you can see yourself on that's gonna be super smooth, that is going to free up your phone, because vlogging on the back cameras of your phone is actually like, it's hard because you can't see yourself and the camera on the front of your phone sucks. And so this is a better option than that. And it has 360 degree sound. It has four microphones on it that I would say if it's not windy are gonna work well. And if you need to add a microphone on later, you can do that. There's actually a creator kit that's gonna take it up to $500 US, but there's tons of great stuff in that creator kit. And I wanna try it. My only question is whether the autofocus is gonna be okay. The last one had a bit of issues. But generally at this kind of wide angle, with this having a smaller sensor, it's bigger than your cell phone sensor a little bit, a little over half an inch, but it's not huge like the other cameras. But generally that means lots of stuff's in focus and hopefully you won't be out of focus. But really interesting option if you're saying, I only got less than 500 bucks. Get on it. I think that's a really cool option. You can make good vlogs with that. Number one. Number two, right here, the Canon M50, not the new Mark II version. It's not worth the extra money. But this version for vlogging, I had so much fun and did a lot of great, amazing projects. There's so many other M50 videos on this channel. I won't get into it too much, but do a quick search if you're serious about the M50. Right now, $550 is sold on B&H. You can also click the Amazon links below. I get a little bit of commission, help support the channel, but buy it from wherever you want. I don't really care. But $550, the kit lens on this is pretty wide. And if I didn't mention that about the first camera, the Pocket 2, it goes from like wide to really wide with the adapter. This one does wide. Again, the other like general Canon digital SLR cameras aren't wide enough. This one's a little bit wider, gets to that true 24 millimeter equivalent on 35 millimeter cameras. There's a whole other video here. If you're curious about lenses and widths for vlogging, I have another video, I'll link it above and below, and it's gonna walk you through all the different kinds of lenses I'm talking about here today, explaining ultra wide versus wide, cinematic, like shallow depth of field, blurry background, kit lenses, and like zoomed in B-roll 50 millimeter lenses. It's a great video and it's kind of fun, and I was being a bit wacky back then, but check it out. It will be a great primer if you start getting confused about lenses and what I'm talking about. Okay, so Canon M50, $550. It's so tough to beat. 1080p video quality is good. You start getting the low light, it's okay. It's not the greatest. But if you want to go to that ultra wide angle vlogging, look for not a whole crazy pile of money, especially compared to competitors. Canon, you can get a good 11 to 22 millimeter for this, but selfie screen, microphone input jack, good kit lens, very easy to use. The colors look great, footage in good light, great. So M50, highly recommended for me. You're not gonna get like crazy super slow motion, 4K, any of that kind of stuff. But for general everyday vlogging, I like it. Next up on our list is the Sony ZV-1, as we good Canadians say, or ZV-1 for those out there. This is based on the legendary Sony RX100 Mark V. If you follow like a Sarah Geechee, she used that for a lot of time. I'm sure there's many other creators. This was a proper pocketable 4K, 120 frames per second, super slow motion, great color, selfie screen, could plug in a microphone, right? I think so. At least on the ZV-1, you can for sure. Just an all-around workhorse with an image-stabilized lens and a great low-light and cinematic lens. It went f1.8 to f2.8. It means it opens up wide, blurs the background, tons of light. All around a fantastic camera, and they've made like a cheaper, a little bit plasticky, but still great pocketable camera that comes with a good windsock thing for if you're outside and audio and it's a bit windy, is going to work reasonably well and capture audio from all the way around. Just a fantastic value proposition. If you're not planning to upgrade lenses, this is such a great option for $750 US. Just fantastic. It's probably the one on this list I'm most serious about because I love the idea of you can almost put it in any pocket and it's always with you. You don't have to build out a big rig like this. So very cool. I like that at $750. A 1-inch sensor isn't as big as like the sensors in this or full frame sensors, but still a very good size. So much bigger than your cell phone. Gonna be pretty good in low light. And in all sorts of ways, built-in ND filter. It's just like, it's like pro level features in a pocketable camera. So there's actually tons of room to grow in learning, which is pretty neat. All right, number 4, 5, and 6 actually all come from the same family. And the cameras that I'm gonna be talking about are the Sony A6000 series. That's A6100, 6400, and 6600. These are new in the last year, I believe. And Sony has always been really good in low light. They've been good, especially the last couple iterations, at giving you like 120 frames per second, super slow motion, Peter McKinnon style B-roll options. And previous generations, like for me, the A6500, I didn't like the colors on it and the battery life was kind of terrible. Now, you can buy cheap third-party batteries to kind of take care of that, but colors, I tried, but I couldn't really fix. These ones, the colors are getting much better. And we're gonna walk through a few options. Now, again, I referenced in another video, about lenses. This is where this is gonna be coming important if you're not familiar with lenses. So it may be worth watching that video, but again, up to you. So the first recommendation, $1,150, is the Sony A6100, but only the body, ditch the kit lens, and add on the Sigma 16mm f1.4. This is a wide lens that is unbelievable in low light and makes super blurry backgrounds that looks cool and different. Now, on other cameras, the focus might struggle, but with Sony's autofocus in video is so good that it can handle working with such a shallow thing. Like, you get close to your face and your eyelashes will be in focus and your nose will be out of focus. Like, it's kind of crazy and it looks cool, but it'll work. And the bonus for this combination is the A6100, all the new 6000 series, are weather sealed, meaning if you have a lens that's also weather sealed, which the 16mm is, it's going to block out kind of dust and sand and moisture and other gunk from getting inside the camera. And that's pretty cool at $1,150. You've got a wildly cinematic vlogging rig that is gonna look really neat. And I had vlogs I did with this 16mm lens on my A6500, and it just looked really cool. And the autofocus is even better now than it was back then. The only thing is, like, you can only zoom with your hands. There's no zooming with the lens because it's just a single focal length, but really cool, especially for like, I need to vlog in a dark space or in a small room where I want it to look kind of like, you see how my background's like a little bit blurry? I have a little bit more space to put the camera back and zoom. If you're in a small room, this is a cool option. Now, the option up from this is really more about swapping the lens. We're gonna keep that same A6100 and it's gonna cost us an extra $400, but we're gonna get an ultra wide angle Sony 10 to 18 millimeter F4 image stabilized. The previous recommendation had no stabilization, so you either need to put a tripod and be very careful with it, or, yeah, put it on a tripod, not just a bendy one, but sit it down or else it can be really shaky. But in this, the Sony 10 to 18 millimeter is that ultra wide angle, Casey Neistat style look where you fit so much more of what's going on. Your face looks a little bit funny, but it's just got that ultra wide angle look. And this one being that it's F4 constant, meaning if you buy the Canon ultra wide angle lens for the M50, it it's variable aperture, meaning as you zoom in, the lens actually gets darker. And you'll notice that in the video that if you're on auto, the camera's kind of adjusting as it gets darker, a little bit brighter, brighter, darker, brighter. This one is constant. It's the same as you zoom in and out. So it's just gonna give you a little bit more pro level consistency. Won't distract the audience if you're zooming in and out and the light's changing. So I really like this lens. I had this lens as well, the 10 to 18 millimeter, my A6500, and I loved it. I just couldn't see myself in the A6500, but this combination and the last option is to just step up the body. So go from an A6100 to an A6400 or a 6600. I like the 6600 because you get in-body image stabilization. It's even smoother. You're getting bigger battery, better battery life, which the other ones are okay. And you're getting 4K 60 frames per second, like some seriously pro features. 6400 and 6600 do HDR, HLG, like crazy color, lighting, like they're super powerful cameras, and Sony's are notoriously good in low light, especially compared to Canon. They just do really well in low light. And so there's kind of three recommendations here. Like it's about $2,000 to get an A6600 and the 10 to 18 millimeter, but that is like a pro level ultra wide angle vlogging look. There's really not much you can't do with that. And so you can step down a little bit and get an A6400, which doesn't have in-body stabilization, but the lens does, and figure that out. But that's just kind of a range to explore if you're going, I wanna have like a pro looking vlogging rig, or maybe you're going, I want that 16 millimeter super shallow cinematic look, but I want it to be stable. Well, pair it with an A6600 and do the math on what that is. But fantastic range there for crop sensor cameras. Now, we're gonna add a couple more $2,000-ish options that are different and interesting depending on what you wanna do. If you want a proper full frame camera, maybe you plan on getting a lot more serious about photography and you want that full frame look, or you just want gorgeous full frame with Canon colors, you can get the Canon EOS RP with an adapter and the Canon 16 to 35 millimeter F4 image stabilized for $2,000. The EOS RP is a full frame mirrorless camera for $900 US. And the recent firmware updates have made it better in that you can actually do 24 frames per second video if you want that cinematic look. And it's just going to look fantastic. I had the EOS R with this 16 to 35 millimeter F4. It's the most gorgeous I've ever seen vlogs look. I've got one, I went to New York, saw Casey Neistat. That just looked great. I have another video, I think I'm wandering around just outside making video. Like everything that came out of the camera looked amazing. And I think the RP would be very close and similar to that full frame. So that's a really interesting option for about $2,000. The last one is for you Micro Four Thirds fans out there, fans of Panasonic or Olympus. You can get the new, how do we say this? EM1 Mark III from Olympus, which has great autofocus, unlike Panasonic, is weather sealed, shoots like 10-bit, 422, 4K, 60 frames per second, I believe, or is it 30? I think it's all the way up to 60, maybe internally or externally. Aren't they starting to do RAW in this camera output if you connect an external drive? But like a pro level camera with some crazy features, and the Olympus 12 to 40 millimeter f2.8 as a kit for $2,100. There's really not much you couldn't do with those two lenses. Like making serious films with those two pieces put together. That 12 to 40 millimeter lens is gorgeous, constant 2.8, very similar. I'm shooting on a 12 to 35, but a very old camera. That is a powerful combo if you want proper, like whatever vlog, what, I don't know what Olympus is like. It might even be RAW, but like they're flat, like cinema, like crazy, crazy stuff. Really interesting option. If you're a Micro Four Thirds shooter, you know what I'm talking about. If not, research it. It's pretty cool. Dave Mays, shout out to him. He loves this camera, good buddy. And yeah, cool stuff. So check out his work on, well, it was Kinoteca. Now he's at the new place. I'm drawing a blank. Anyway, last option for you who are just like, I have so much money to burn. I'm a rich doctor and a philanthropist and I trade Bitcoin and I have so much money. The new Sony A7S III is just the camera that everybody dreamed that it was gonna be. The ultimate low light video, slow motion, 4K, HDR, like just every single video feature you could want. Finally added a selfie screen and the proper autofocus. It is the greatest mirrorless kind of compact camera out there. Pair it with the Sony Zeiss 16-35 f4 for some extra stabilization. You don't need the 2.8 on that camera. It's just so good at low light. That will look beautiful in so many ways and is just kind of the ultimate vlogging rig. So there's 10 options of the cameras that I'd be thinking about at different price points. What did I miss? That's what did I not talk about that you're saying, well, what about this camera? This camera's a great option. You missed this one. Or I was hoping that you would talk about this one. Drop a comment below. I'll be happy to chat about it. Let's talk about it. Let's discuss. Let's figure it out. Happy to have the conversation going. And the last and final point is, are there any other cameras coming that I'm excited about that aren't on this list yet? And I follow a lot of the rumor sites. There's actually not. My hope was that the M50 Mark II was going to bring a whole host of new features that would kind of match it up against the Sony's, but keep some of the Canon goodness. And it just didn't deliver that. And there's like the new Canon M6 Mark II, which would be a good vlogging camera, but it's too expensive for what it is. And I think the Sony's would actually kind of do a better job. Plus they have better lens options. Canon's M series lenses are a little bit limited. Panasonic, they are bringing their good autofocus progressively into their cheaper cameras. Their cheap cameras right now, their autofocus is bad. It's like Panasonic, don't. But as they bring them down, there will be some other good options. Sony just recently came out with their cameras. There's not a whole lot of new stuff coming. It's actually been 2020 has been great for tech. But yeah, so I would say right now is a great time to buy a camera. There's not going to be anything coming out that's going to revolutionize your world a month or two down the road and go, oh, and all these cameras you can create great stuff with and build your skills, learn about telling stories. It's not about the cameras anyway. So yeah, good stuff. Hopefully that helped. That was literally one take after I thought I recorded this once already for 20 minutes and I was in photo mode. So I took a photo. I wasn't recording. So good for me. Yay. I'm Dustin Rivas. Thanks for watching.